Just the audio.
We are live.
And now we're live.
We are officially live, motherfuckers. episode 20. Oh, my bad.
No, go ahead.
Episode 21 of On Tap with Southside Collection. Welcome, everybody. Carlos, how you doing, brother?
Man, we're coming off that Bloom Fest. I'm feeling really good.
I'm honestly feeling great, like, because of that shit. Tim Woods has a lasting impression, man. Like, he... Love your homies, man. There's no problem with that.
The crowd was lit, too. The crowd was lit for everybody.
Yes. shit, we got one of the artists in the house.
Hell yeah.
It started hot with Villain Posse.
Yeah.
Would love to have them on the show at some point.
I don't know, the more we keep adding mics.
Oh, yeah, that's true. Jen never technically told us how old he was. And so the more you ask, the less you know.
Yeah.
Whatever. but nah, man, it was just a great show. Honestly, thank you, Tim, and your entire camp. TJ, like, y'all set us the fuck up. Like, there were parts that got missed out, and honestly, it was not a problem at all.
Yeah.
Like, we had some games planned, but the way the night worked out, things
Everyone was already turned up, too. I saw Seven. Seven was turned up.
That boy Seven?
Yeah, I don't know where he went, but he was turned.
You can't tell me anything is possible.
Yeah,
whatever, bro.
someone told me Bobby Earth was out there. You know, everyone was had a nice
someone who didn't even know Bobby Earth was like, "Hey, that little Asian dude on the stage is like, that's a fly ass producer. That's Bobby Earth."
And yeah.
Like, well, he's lit.
I saw him dancing on the stage. He was getting it. And then someone told me he was drunk. I was like, "Oh man, well, he was getting it on the stage, man."
Speaking of Bobby Earth dancing, he's been getting into that Flipagram shit where it's like super fast videos.
Yeah.
Killing it, Bobby. Yeah. Keep doing that shit. That's just hilarious. If not for everyone, I'm gonna enjoy it just because of how hilarious it is.
For the first time, or for the last time, in a while, we're gonna talk about the Texans.
True.
It's an L.
Oh, fuck the Texans.
It's an L.
It's an L.
It's an L.
I mean, if we would have put Tommy One Savage in there, I think we would have been all right.
Well, Brock, you know, and you said it the best earlier. Go ahead and tell how you said it. Actually, we're about Houston fans and getting a hard on.
Well, if you've been a fan of the show and you've listened, you already know my stance on my pessimism towards the team. And I wish everyone else shared that pessimism.
Yeah.
Because going into the half losing by 1 point to a team that is definitely better than you already, but gives you so many opportunities to score.
Yeah.
Watching the entire Texans season in one game. It was turnovers by the defense.
Yeah.
A great fucking half by the defense. Like, wonderful half by the defense. And, like, they showed, what is it, chinks in the armor of Tom Brady?
Yeah.
Like, the defense showed up, got the ball for the offense.
They're stopping the run, too.
They couldn't get the
ball.
Yeah, I mean, they had that one kick return, and then, I mean, it's Deion Lewis, right?
Yeah.
Yeah, he just killed it. But still, you can give up those three touchdowns and win the football game by converting on turnovers.
Exactly.
But it's like, but then Texans fans, love you guys. We're all from the same city. I want everyone to succeed and do well in life.
Exactly.
But seriously, get the fuck off of social media during football games. We're not good enough. We are not the Steelers. We're not the other three teams that are currently in conference championship games. Yeah. We're not the Patriots. This guy was like, he's a Patriots fan. I'm friends with him on Facebook. Yeah. Could not have been more cordial about all of it. You want to know why? Because you go in with
it's a gentleman's game.
You go in with your shirt tucked. And you know you're going to beat our ass, and then you do it, and it's fine.
Well, real talk, though. I mean, like, all week to talk out of New England, because, you know, I'm vice president of the Patriots fan club here, and all talk out of New England, all the show, and stuff you listen to.
Rooted.
Is, like, it was like, it's going to be a blowout. You're going to throw your helmet on the field and beat them, and I was like, I don't subscribe to that. It's the NFL, any given Sunday, they have a great defense.
Yeah.
I knew we were better, but, you know, but what happened.
Three turnovers,
things I didn't expect. And I'm like, I was sweating at 14-13. I'm like, man, this is not what I expected.
Oh, yeah. And I had optimism.
In second half. But, you know, it's like the better team ended up winning. But, again, like you said, you have a quarterback that can convert and get some scores other than field goals or get past the 50, then that's a different game.
Yeah.
You know, and they're almost there. They have a great defense. I mean, Jadeveon Clowney is ridiculous.
Yeah.
I have something I want to say about him, too.
I mean, it was crazy.
Yeah, like, because the thing the Patriots do really well is they cancel out your biggest weapon.
Yeah.
And our biggest weapons on defense are Jadeveon Clowney and Whitney Mercilus right now. And they're still finding ways to stunt where Jadeveon Clowney gets double teamed, Mercilus just sneaks in there. Yeah. And then if they worry about Mercilus, Jadeveon Clowney's just a strong fuck. And so he gets through.
I also.
By the way, remember all you guys hating on him because he was just never going to be healthy, and now you love him.
Yeah,
see?
He's that man.
You got to learn how to treat your team, man. You get what you earn.
I think Brock could have threw the ball down the field more in the game. I watched a lot of the highlights and a lot of our successful plays, and we didn't really have a lot of – like, we had the one that he dropped, Braxton Miller.
Bro, it was Will Fuller, best throw there of Brock go. Osweiler's career.
Yeah.
You're never going to see that potential from him again.
No. It's trash.
But, man, that was the story of Will Fuller's career. If you think back to the first game of the season,
yeah.
He had one bounce off his numbers on a deep route. Granted, he made up for it later in the game with a screen, and like he looked good later.
He made up for it in the beginning of the season, really.
Yeah.
That's his knock, though,
his hands.
Catch, you know? Which, he's got great speed, though.
And he'll burn somebody, and like he had a step on his...
could have changed momentum. That could have changed momentum so much.
Because I think it was still a one-point game whenever he dropped that. Or maybe it was...
Maybe it was
3 or 4.
Okay, four of them, four. But I mean, the thing, like, we still shut down McKinney, who's your leading tackler. And Deion burned him on that play. But,
several times McKinney got burned.
But, it's just, you're right there. And, like, I've seen Texans fans talk about getting rid of J.J. Watt or this and that and the other. And, like, whether you agree or you don't agree, like, we did the same thing when Brady was out for those four games.
Yeah.
And, like, oh, Jimmy G, like, we don't need Brady. Yeah. And it's like, slow down.
We need him.
Yeah, slow down, man.
To that credit, The New England Patriots, I'll just give y'all this. I mean, you've already the respect has been shown that it needs to be earned.
Or it's there just, you go. Yeah.
But it's a well-oiled machine that it'll succeed with or without Tom Brady. However, it won't be great without Tom Brady. Like they beat us 27-0.
Cameras and practices.
Yeah. Belichick's not gonna let his guys Facebook Live.
I didn't even watch that video, but. It just seems like it was unnecessary. Yeah.
It's just Antonio Brown like not listening to his coach and caring about how many followers he's got. It's like, come on, dude.
It's a weird thing once you become a famous athlete, because then you also step into the celebrity realm, which then starts leading you into something we talked about earlier, how like my dad will knock J.J. Watt for being in commercials but not in the game on Sunday. I'm like, you got to understand that they balance their lives.
Watches this, he's like, I don't knock him.
My dad doesn't even have a Facebook. My mom made him a Facebook so they could be married. On Facebook.
Yeah.
And, it's the modern-day courthouse is Facebook. Yeah.
It's not real.
I haven't been to a Facebook wedding.
That's 100% true. Though. A Facebook wedding?
Yeah, with Facebook Live.
Yeah.
What can happen?
We can get somebody married on this show.
Who wants to get married? Come down here right now. Hit us up in the comments or something.
And I'm sure there's a on-tap joke to be done with that.
I'm an ordained dudist priest. I don't know if you've seen the movie The Big Lebowski, but I did join that religion.
That's a bet. Well, we can drown in our sorrows later about the Texans. We're not in it. After this week, you and I are going to make a bet. We still have to figure out what the parameters of this bet.
Who you got going into the Super Bowl?
I think I told you when we talked about it first.
Yeah,
Packers and Patriots.
Right. Okay.
I would love to see you go against Aaron Rodgers. I mean, he's hot right now, man. And Brady versus Rodgers would be great. But I think Atlanta, don't sleep on Atlanta. I think Atlanta's a good football team.
Yeah. Atlanta looks very good. I mean, their defense... is the story of a lot of other good teams is it could be better, but it's not hurting them.
Real staunch defense. Texans were the last, like, in my opinion, solid, great number one defense. Like, the Pittsburgh Steelers would have a good defense, but...
Yeah, they always have a good defense.
Right.
It's just expected them at this point.
So, I think that Atlanta has a good shot at anybody. They can definitely throw the ball with Green Bay.
I see that Packers and the Falcons game going like high, like combined 80.
Sure.
Well, I can tell you right now, if it's the Falcons and the Patriots, that's gonna be crazy.
That's gonna be a wild game.
That's one that Matt Ryan has been preparing for his whole life. He hasn't really gotten that far.
That's what the dog's gonna come
out.
I think Matt Ryan's owed one.
Oh, man.
See, so it wouldn't even hurt you that much.
Patriots got to win, but he's a BC kid, you know. But he.
I mean, no matter what, they got to play in Houston.
That's right.
you going to the Super Bowl if the Patriots make it?
I mean, I feel like I got to because it's a once-in-a-lifetime thing, but obviously I don't want to pay $5,000 to sit up in, like, the nosebleeds, you know?
Buy the tickets now.
What you mean? Watch it at home.
Yeah, that's the best
go to a bar. Go to a bar. Yeah.
I'm going to check out some parties, though, and I'm going to go to the NFL Experience. So
that's always fun, man.
Parties. There's all kinds of stuff. Man,
I'm a stay-at-home, my son.
Smart
my
wife.
There you go.
Amateur. It's like New Year's.
Tobacco.
And drink some beer.
I got you. Like it. Yeah, this man said he's onto the craft beer. One of the few like artist guests that's already showed up onto craft beer. Some people show up and they're like, I don't even drink. I'm like, oh, man.
I like to drink it.
Yeah, hey, if it's in front of you, you'll drink it, so that's good enough. Speaking of the Super Bowl, the night before the Super Bowl, we'll be at Axelrad.
True that.
With a pop-up event with brand new designs, new shirts.
Four new shirts, I believe.
New hats.
Two new hats.
The whole squad will be there.
Yeah.
I requested off work already.
There we go. I shouldn't be working.
So that means you will be.
Hell yeah.
That's life.
Yeah. No, it would be a good time. Last time we went to Axelrad, it was a really good time. A lot of great people, and it was for a great cause. This time we're just going there.
This time we're just going there for our own selfish reasons, and I couldn't be more happy.
And I'm probably going to have the UFC on the UFC in Houston that same day.
Yeah.
Oh, really?
Yeah.
That's smart.
Super Bowl?
Yeah.
That's crazy.
Super Bowl weekend. Yeah.
That's the thing is lit. People bet on like the traffic that's already coming in. Like,
this city's about to be stupid.
You go, oh, man, they're already spending this much. They don't mind spending this much more.
So they're already in town.
Clubs downtown. Like,
they literally are building a club for like the week and like that 2 week period. Like if you follow any of the Texans players on Twitter, they're literally like advertising themselves as appearance people now. Like, I'll show up at your Super Bowl party for da da da.
There's a thing Briley's doing it's a Texas fest or whatever, but like, I think it's hosted by Jamal Charles, and they're gonna have some craft breweries there. And a bunch of celebrities, of course, but
yeah.
Jamal will be there, but like, they're going to pour some beer out there. So there's all kinds of stuff like that going on.
Yeah,
That's how I grabbed Derek Lewis for this show. I saw he was doing an event, and he's like, come have a beer. I was like, he likes beer.
Nice.
Boom. And now we got the future UFC heavyweight champion.
And probably the cleanest segue we've ever had.
True.
On on-tap history.
True again. Thank you, Super Bowl. Thank you, Derek Lewis.
Yeah, Derek Lewis is going to be fighting soon, and David DaCosta is going to be fighting
soon. Someone finally signed up to get their ass kicked by David DaCosta. Travis Brown already wanted to get his ass kicked just by continuing his career.
Yeah.
And not hiring a new fucking coach. But
Man, he's about to get the Ronda Rousey treatment, I think. It's going to be bad.
What, meme fucking...
Oh, man, Travis...
His memes are great.
Yeah. I didn't even touch on how, like...
His and her memes.
As a Houston fan, it was nice to see the Cowboys lose.
Yeah. But we didn't even talk about that.
I didn't even mind them winning or losing. It was cooler that they lost.
They came back. They were trying.
The memes were fire.
Yeah.
Like, we live in an age now where memes are entertainment. And, man, are they fucking fast. People are just watching the game like, all right, what else do they have to make fun of?
Dude, I follow Cried and Jordan, the Cried and Jordan on Twitter, just so I can see. Because as soon as there's a loss, it doesn't matter who it is.
Doesn't matter.
Whoever runs that has already got the Crying Jordan on all kinds of stuff. It's hilarious.
They're killing it. The Crying Jordan.
They probably got a folder full of it, though. Like, just anything and everything.
Oh, yeah.
You know what I'm saying?
Pretty much if they know that there's these games going on, they just have players ready to go.
That's how I do it.
If you're trying to rule the internet with memes.
Fuck yeah.
Well, fuck it. We're trying to rule the internet with podcasts.
Fuck yeah.
We got Josh Samples in the house on behalf of Green Flash and Alpine Brewing. And we also have
Jonny Bahama.
Jonny motherfucking Bahama.
Coming up in the game. What's going down? EGP, new signee to EGP.
What's going down, y'all? Man, I'm a little buzzing right now, man. We're drinking on some good brew over here.
I need
man.
Some more beer. We all need some more beer.
More beer.
My bad.
But, man, you know, I was just on the topic of sports. Like I said, go Giants. Texas suck.
Hey,
I love Houston. I love Houston.
No beer for Johnny.
No beer for Johnny. I'm just going ahead and say, man, it just at least upper management, so they made so many bad decisions.
One of the things is. How bad the Giants or the Texans?
The Texans.
Oh, yeah. Like, Rick Smith makes awful decisions and then gets rewarded for them.
And you know what? And they always have a team that people still wonder, can they go to the Super Bowl? But then it's just you want to know what the problem is, man. You need the right quarterback to take you anywhere.
And they recently just fired the offensive coordinator, which I think was a good move.
It was a great move.
Yeah.
They need to get rid of the whole coaching staff. They need to restock. They got.
I feel bad for O'Brien though.
O'Brien, he did his job.
True.
He tried. He can't. He didn't pick Oswald.
True. If they were to lose him,
he just not wanted to boot start.
Yeah.
He wanted Savage.
They're gonna fire him. Savage. His name is Savage.
Right. How do you not believe in him?
Yeah.
That's a good point.
You know what I'm saying?
But, so. Well, shit. Josh, welcome to the show, man.
Thanks.
Thank you very much.
Yeah, I'm glad to be here.
Like we mentioned with your wife, Briley, like, we are a Houston beer-centered, but we also are just craft beer lovers. So
good,
man,
it's good beer wherever it's from, man.
Exactly. And you're repping on behalf of Green Flash and Alpine out of San Diego.
Yeah, and Virginia Beach.
And Virginia Beach.
So technically both bi-coastal, right, as we say?
That, yeah, that's
very progressive.
Very progressive. They can't even assume your coast now.
That's right, that's right, that's right. So we're both coasts.
That's great.
We go to both bathrooms.
I fucked up my question earlier when I was asking which Virginia. I totally was thinking the Carolinas, because there's one that's just clearly worse than the other one, which is surprisingly not the one that waves more Confederate flags.
That's actually is surprising. No, we went Virginia. We were the first brewery to go out there, and then now since like Stone and some other guys have gone out there, and it's just synonymous for us. You know, San Diego is a military town, and you know, the Navy's out there, and then you've also got the beach and all the nonsense. So we added that to the Virginia Beach. Same thing, just gets a little colder out there.
Yeah, I got you.
And there's military out there too, so it just works for us.
That, and it literally helps you just patrol the whole
cheaper beer, and you can I think it's like east of the Mississippi, everything comes from Virginia Beach, and then everything west of the Mississippi comes from San Diego. So beer in Texas comes from San Diego. It's like 100 miles closer in San Diego. It's crazy.
I was gonna say, if you have some weird like existing like thought about where you wanted it from, there you go. You got OG San Diego Green Flash beer. OG. It's the same beer.
There you go.
And then you guys, so Green Flash has been going at it for a while, though.
Yeah, 14 years.
14 years. And so how long have they been, or y'all have been in Virginia Beach?
Virginia Beach just opened just this year in November. Sure. Okay. So
I got you.
Brand new, just starting to produce beer little by little. And probably about middle of the year we'll be at capacity of both and just cranking it out. You know,
I got
it's going to take a little bit to get everything up, but you know, we've gotten people transferred over there. We've gotten beer slowly producing out of there. So about mid-year we'll be over there and we'll be doubling our capacity. We were a little bit like 92,000 barrels last year, so we'll be well over 100 at the end of this year, which puts us up there with, you know, the big boys, the Stones, the Sierra Nevada. I mean, we're around 14 years, but we're top 30 brewery, but we're kind of under the radar. You know, kind of like the Atlanta Falcons of craft beer.
Hey.
Like, we've been doing good things, but people are like, well, you're not Stone. And you're like, well, respect.
But we've got...
Put some respect on our name, right?
You put know, some spec on it.
Come on now.
So, I like that.
You know.
But now we got Devontae Freeman healthy.
And just in case he's not healthy, we got Tevin Coleman.
Well, that's it. We got Green Flash, and we got Alpine. So Tevin Coleman's our Alpine. There you go. And, man, look at that. I like how I made that happen. I don't know how to do that.
Just, man, if we can make everything tie together as smoothly as it has so far...
Yeah.
This is going to go as well as Jonny claimed it will.
I already knew it was going to go. Good vibes about
it. It's lit. Recently, though, you guys acquired Alpine. Is that the way the story goes?
Yeah, okay. And that is the story. Okay, we acquired them about 2 years ago now in November. It was a kind of a handshake agreement at first. We were brewing beer for them for about 13 months prior. And it was just kind of one of those things where we thought, you know, let's help these guys out, because they were going to have to build a new brewery. I don't know if you've ever been to Alpine, but if you have a good chance, go to Alpine, California, which is the very tip of San Diego County, in the mountains, and it's a small, small facility, like tiny, like it's no bigger than a garage, it seems like, and they're brewing world-class beers out of there.
Yeah.
So we helped them out, you know, and we wanted to get them mass distribution, and so we've done that, and so it's great. I mean, they were ranked the number 6 brewery in the world last year by Rate Beer, so.
Shit. That Nelson, I think, is like 100%.
Yeah, well, the Pure Hoppiness I brought is 100.
True.
And, you know, I mean, we make some dank beers out there, don't worry.
Yeah.
But, yeah, that stuff is, they make some of the best IPAs you'll ever have. I mean, the Duet is killer.
Was the Duet the first one?
The first one we launched here, their first beer, I don't recall, it's probably Alpine Ale, I believe, which is kind of like a pale ale. But Duet's the first one we launched. We have Hoppy Birthday.
Hoppy Birthday, man, people love that shit, because it's...
Yeah, I love it. I just love the name. But the beer is, it's we call it, like, we basically say, you know, it's an IPA anywhere else, but out of California, it's a pale ale.
Yeah.
5 hops. 6.5, it's 7% alcohol, but it's got pretty high IBU content, so pretty hoppy for a pale ale.
Yeah. Hey, I'm down with the hops, man.
Yeah, we all are, man.
Is that something you see, like, I feel like that is one thing you guys are known for, like, you say you're kind of under the radar, but for any of the beers you guys do sell, especially with Alpine, it seems like their IPAs have reached Texas in the most, like, distribution, or, like, in the most mass quantity. Do you guys just get known for the hoppiness, or...
Yeah, I mean, so Green Flash's story was, you know, we started 14 years ago, and Mike hired a brewer named Chuck Silva, who's created his own brewery now. And Mike went to him, our owner, and said, look, you know, I want you to brew something that says California, that says West Coast. And so that's where West Coast IPA came from. Okay. And that's the one that put us on the map. That's our flagship. We trademarked the name West Coast IPA. Nobody can say that anymore. So, yeah, if you say West Coast IPA, you got to say West Coast style IPA.
Oh, that's fucking awesome. So, and Anchor steamed it.
Yeah, right, exactly. And so that's the one that got us on the map. And it was dank, hoppy, you know, citrusy, piney, resiny, all those good notes you're looking for. And it just helped usher in the whole West Coast trend.
Yeah.
It became a thing because of West Coast IPA. Now, Stone IPA were making great IPAs. You know, Ballast Point making good IPAs. Alesmith, those guys were always doing that stuff. But West Coast kind of set the world on fire, and that kind of became the quintessential West Coast IPA.
You go and look to that as like comparative with anything else that says West Coast style.
Yeah. So yeah, we've been, and since then it's been, oh, you guys make the hoppy beers, which, you know, as craft has grown, is a little bit more okay.
Yeah.
But it's, you know, now we've got some lighter things like the GFB we're drinking. We got some lighter things we're working on. Is that every man's beer, you know, that if you don't like hops, it's still delicious.
And that GFB is a blonde ale, you were saying?
Yeah, it's a blonde ale, 4.8%.
To hit the market.
It'll hit the market next week. It's pretty good, right?
Damn, it's the best beer Jonny Bahama's ever had. It's like, and you haven't even had the 100% double IPA.
Like, you want to drink a beer because you want to chill, you know?
Exactly.
And it's not too strong. It's not too light. It's perfect.
That's what we call patio pounders. You can drink them all
day. Yeah,
patio pound. I like to pum pum pound. This
is perfect. Balcony pounding. This is perfect. No, man. I've noticed that becoming more of a trend, too, though. Like, I think about 2 years ago, and this might just coincide with when I really started getting into craft beer, was that everyone was looking for the hoppiest and the Imperial IPA. Like, I just want to drink like 4, 8, 9, 10 percenters.
Yeah.
And now it's kind of like they realize, okay, you can make all this flavor into a 6.5, a 7.
Absolutely.
A 5. Like, there's session IPAs out there for a reason.
Well, there's a thing for everybody. Like, the whole purpose of this beer is that, you know, in the craft beer industry, we spend so much time like smelling it and trying to figure out what hops are in it and talking about it. Like, that's cool and all, but there's occasions where you don't want to do that. You're playing pool, you're mowing the lawn, you're watching the game, just give me another round, just give me another pitcher of GFB. Like, it's not, you don't want to talk about the hops, you just want a good beer, like you said, you know. And that's, so this is kind of like an every occasion beer.
I got you.
You know, that's what it's for. But there are places for hops, man. There's some people who want that dank, you know, hoppy stuff. And, you know, I'm the same way. That's kind of really exclusively what I drink. And I guess it's because I work for a brewery that makes that.
Yeah, it helps. Yeah,
you've got that at the ready. Equal opportunity drinker. I'll drink whatever's good.
Exactly. You know? If it tastes right, I'll drink it.
Yeah.
I will say I look more for, like, especially IPAs, heavy on the hops.
Sure, sure.
And if I'm going stout, like, I was talking about it with someone at work today where I was like, some people don't like that coffee taste. I want as much coffee as you can throw into a stout.
You look like Barry Hatchett.
Yes.
Yeah. So what do you like? I mean, what's your go? I mean, just whatever.
Man, I don't really drink beers. I like whatever they pick up.
You say your girl got you turned on to it. So.
My girl got me on craft beers when we you know, we started dating. She, like, you know, she doesn't really drink either, but she said, you know, if you drink a brew, she prefer a craft beer.
That's a good woman.
So, you know, woman. I definitely,
you done right.
Shout out Lily Aviana, that's my baby.
Lily, what's your favorite beer?
My favorite beer is Eighth Wonder, the Rocket Fuel.
Rocket Fuel is good.
It's good beer.
So I drank all those, whatever else. You know, the H-E-B section.
Yep. You know? Well, you spend like 30 minutes in a grocery store, now you're like, man, what beer do I want? Which is the craziest thing. You know, specs, you're like, I can sit here all day trying to figure out what I want.
Let me tell you the worst. I was at H-E-B. It was right before the Texans game. It was like a Texans game, like randomly in the season. And it was like a pick six thing. So I was picking them off the wall. Finally, some guy comes up to me and goes, it's only 11:30. I can't buy beer yet. I'm trying to buy beer before the Texans game. And I was like, fuck.
Well, man. I'm going
to
need these 30 minutes, motherfucker. You got a good selection. You're welcome.
Can you move your clock forward?
Yeah. Right. Come on, man. Be holy about this.
Yeah, right. I do that all the time, man. Forget.
So, what's the reception whenever you sell your beer down here in Houston?
Well, we've been around for a while in Texas. I think it's like 6 or 7 years. We didn't have representation until I started, really, which was 4 years in February.
Nah. Okay.
And, you know, the reception's been good. People, you know, we had a name for ourselves, kind of. People knew West Coast IPA, and we started bringing out other stuff, and then people were excited about it, you know. But it's a competitive market. It's like anything else. You know, there's a lot of breweries popping up left and right in Houston. It's hard to keep up with.
Yeah, they are.
And then just in general across the country and in the state of Texas, and you got, you know, Bell's coming in 2017, like all these competitive breweries that make really great beer. So the shelves are shrinking for us, and it's tough. But the reception's been good. It's just, you know, getting that time in front of the buyer. And I always tell people, like, you know, some regional breweries may have issues with local. I don't have an issue with it, because if at some point they're getting my beer in their mouth, you know, they're gonna at least, you know, they're gonna light my beer. Eventually, yeah. If they're trying Eighth Wonder, they're gonna find their way to a Green Flash at some point, you know. So that's kind of the way I look at it. So it's good for everybody, you know.
It's good to look at it like that too, because you could have the idea in it. When we had Taylor here, it was a good discussion about like, man, just don't be a dick. Like, have fun selling your beer. Like you said,
don't be a craft dick. Yeah.
Yeah. Just like. Beer. Like, I mean, obviously you want your product to sell the most, sure. Like, because it definitely, it keeps your job, sure. But it's also, like, the best way to look at it is, okay, well, if you're drinking Eighth Wonder Blank or Eureka Heights this, there's our style of that beer. There's a beer that you will also like in that same realm, yeah. And it's just a matter of putting them onto
it. People just need to learn that, like, you know, if it's not a good beer to you, doesn't mean it's not a good beer. It's just not for you.
Exactly.
And that's the thing where we want to preach that education to people is like, look, you know, you don't have to like it. I don't expect everybody to love my IPAs, but, you know, when I do grocery stores, people are like, oh, IPA is the grossest thing ever. I'm like, look, they're not all created equal. If you don't like it, that's fine, but we want to get you turned on in the right direction. As long as you're drinking good beer, that's all I care about, you know?
Which kind of goes into some other things you guys have is not just hop beer, obviously. You've got the C2C lager. You've got the passion fruit wheat kicker.
So, yeah, that's like the kind of talking about, like, we've kind of expanded our portfolio to be there for everybody, you know, whereas like for all a long time it's just IPA, and like you said, that's not what you want all the time. You know, if it's 100 degrees in Texas, the last thing you want to do is really sit on the patio and pound a West Coast IPA necessarily. Not many people
it'll have you sweating about as much as drinking like a heavy
stout.
Don't
tell me how to live my life.
You're not the boss of me.
I'm gonna do what I want.
But yeah, so we came out with a wheat ale called Passion Fruit Kicker. We use passion fruit black tea and puree in it, and it's tart, not sweet. It kind of drinks like a goza.
Yeah,
awesome. Just hit the market in cans now. We've got bottles out there, but we're just coming out cans with that here.
Smart.
Yeah, so smart, and then wicked smart, as we say. And then we've got C2C Lager, which is just another patio pounder. It's a light, easy, unfiltered pilsner that's, you know, again, it's another beer you can drink when it's 100 degrees. And then, you know, this GFB, and got, yeah, so we're not all about the hops now. We're kind of expanding our portfolio to get to the every drinker that's not ready for the IPA.
Yeah.
And work your way up to it, you know.
Exactly. I had a guy tell me the other night, he goes, and this is really, in my opinion, kind of an issue, but hey, it led to you guys getting some sales. He was like, I drink by the brewery name. Like, I don't, like, if I see Green Flash or Lagunitas, he'll just order that beer. It didn't matter. It could have been a word, like, it could have been not West Coast IPA. It just so happened to be West Coast IPA, and it was the one he loved.
Sure.
And so it worked out double time for him.
See, and that's cool. Like, and reputation's great, but, you know, it's you know, in your situation, it's great because you get to tell people that they haven't heard of it. Like, no, this is comparable to West Coast. It's not the same beer, but it's good because of this, you know, whether it's 8 Wonder or Carbach or whoever we talk about, you know, it's just, that's the kind of thing. And that's cool reputation to have.
Yeah.
But, you know, I want people to be broadening their horizons. I mean, of course, by Green Flash.
Well,
but,
yeah.
You know.
And I think that's what helps you guys, like, being able to get your portfolio, like, more, just expanding it is.
I was literally about to say the same
thing. Yeah, because then it's like, you can go, okay, well, you like West Coast, but then, okay, we have Soul Style IPA.
Reach more people.
Yeah.
This beer will be at those dive bars that aren't ready for craft yet.
Exactly.
Beer will be at, we're looking at, you know, House of Blues and things like that. We want to put this in 19-2, those big stovepipe cans that, you know, they're crushable. Beers you can drink while you're listening to a show or whatever, or you're at the game. This is what this is, and it's not going to tear you up too much because it's not, you know, 7%.
Yeah. Exactly. You don't catch yourself halfway.
Hey, I'm not going to lie to you. You want this beer.
See, when we get big, when it gets big, we just need it bigger. We
exactly.
need a sponsor, and then we got we sponsor some shows, and we've done that before, actually.
We're going to chop it up. Don't worry.
All right. All right. Got a spokesman right now.
Boom. This is like Diddy for
this happened at Southside Collection, though. We're gonna remember this.
We're the connectors.
The collections.
Southside Connection. You know?
The connection with the collection.
Some cheesy 80s, like transition music.
Yeah.
I got it. One of y'all's products I definitely wanted to get into was the Treasure Chest.
Mm. Yeah.
A beer to drink and to support.
Like, yeah, it's a really cool thing. So one of our co-founders, Lisa Hinkley, is a 5-year breast cancer survivor. It'll be 6 this next year. And so since then, she's been diagnosed. We've been coming out with a beer every year for breast cancer research. And so literally everything that's made that beer, any swag we come out with that beer, anything we do with that beer is donated. And then all the money we make off it, it's $1 per pint sold usually. And then, of course, the Flying Saucer did some really badass raffles where we raised a ton of money and some support from other breweries. Anything goes to, you know, the PreventCancer.org Foundation, and that's where we've been. So every year we've done it. I think this year, a couple 20,000 or something like that, something ridiculous. Like Saucer did, I think 6,000 itself Yeah. Or 17,000 or something like that. Stupid like that.
I know at our store personally, like, they made it a point. Like,
yeah.
Obviously because it's for a good cause, but, like, sure. They wanted us on that. And it was easy to sell. It's an easy sell, man.
Yeah. And it's a good cause. And, like, that makes me happy because, like, at the end of the day, like, if you don't like the beer, whatever. But for me, it's about raising money for a thing that cancer that affects everybody one way or another. And that's... You know, that's the thing for us. So I think it's cool we do that, and I think we've raised a lot of money for it, and we're going to keep doing that every year, and we're going to probably come back to the saucer again next year, and we do it with other people across the country. I mean, this is nationwide, not just Texas. So it's a cool deal, and, like, you know, great, clever name, Treasure Chest. Come on.
Yeah, right.
And we always do, like, the Hula Girl, or we do a different draw, but it's a, you know, it's a hibiscus, grapefruit, prickly pear IPA. It's real light, but it's good. So you guys raise a lot of money over there, and we've raised a lot of money across the country. So
which is awesome.
The Susan G. Cohen also backs it too, right?
That's we did. So in certain areas they do, but they can't take, like, donations based off alcohol sales or something weird like that. So we donate everything to prevent cancer. Now in Virginia Beach, we do a Treasure Chest Fest, where we do, like, a whole day, and we have a bunch of breweries come out, and we'll have, like, some live music and whatnot. And because at our new brewery, we have, like, bocce ball courts, like, it's huge.
Yeah.
And we have this, like, stage where we're gonna do live music and stuff. So. Yeah, it's awesome. And we raise a ton of money. And it's a cool cause to be a part of, because, I mean, you know, not only do you get to drink a good beer, but you also get to, like, have a purpose by it. Like, oh, I'm kind of helping. Like, my dollar helps. You know?
Exactly. And it really does give people that sense of, like, helping. Because it's like, you were already going to show, you were already at the bar, and then you heard about it. So you planned on having a beer anyway.
It's not too much to ask. It's $1. Yeah.
Exactly.
Yeah. So. Yeah, it's a cool deal.
Why not help out?
Right? Yeah.
And then. I also wanted to talk about Cellar 3.
Yeah.
That's been going on, something you guys have been doing for quite some time, or
It's a couple years now. It's our third facility, I guess, and it's Cellar 3, so it's our third cellar. It's actually away from the brewery. It's a wild yeast and, you know, barrel aging facility. We don't do any production there whatsoever. Okay. It's just literally where we take all our barrels, have whiskey and whatnot in it. Or had whiskey in it, and then we age the liquid there, and then we bottle out there, and then everything. So we'll take it in trucks over from San Diego, freshly brewed, and then put it in the tanks and stuff like that. So
I got you.
And you know, you got to be very careful with that because, you know, infections and whatnot. But
exactly.
So yeah.
Is that set up as, like, a tap room itself as well, or no?
Yeah, okay. It's super nice.
That's badass.
Do a lot of cool beer events there, a lot of cool beer dinners, and I mean, you're talking bourbon barrel aged stouts, all kinds of crazy stuff over there. Some sours. I brought one tonight. We'll try the Blank Tart Barrique.
Sounds good.
They have these fancy Belgian names that trip me up. They're still good beer. Like,
exactly.
You know?
Yeah.
Yeah. So.
And so, yeah, I remember the first time I saw it, I was like, okay, that's the Cellar 3. Like, I'm waiting for the Cellar 4. And then I caught on. I was like, no, this is a whole series of beers. Like, they're going to release several different ones. And I watched the video of all the barrels. Yeah. Jesus Christ.
Yeah, I mean, it's cool. If you ever go to San Diego, check it out, man. It's awesome because there's just barrels upon barrels, stacks on stacks.
Yeah.
And it's crazy. And it's just liquid aging, whether it's a tequila barrel-aged triple or a, you know, bourbon barrel-aged stout, you know, whatever it may be. So it's some crazy stuff out there. It's pretty cool.
That's what's up, man.
You got a favorite, Jonny, between bourbon and tequila?
No.
Either or.
I honestly try to stay away from that type of stuff. When I was younger, you know, anything that was in a bottle... You know, we put it back.
That's a good drinking policy.
True.
Yeah.
Why be a bitch about it?
I don't really do it.
Why throw up rum?
That's how I knew we were going to be friends.
I say the Green Flash. I fell in love with a brew right here.
Nice. Hey,
this is some good.
Johnny's trying to get on that Virginia Beach stage.
Yeah, we'll get him on that stage, man.
My sister's out in Virginia. So she's in there for us.
Oh, well, you have to hit me up, man. We'll if you go visit her, we'll take care of your brewery.
Definitely.
I love some people at the brewery. It's so much fun, man. And buying them a couple beers is great.
And I'm gonna definitely try it. We're gonna definitely do all that.
We'll hook up and make sure it happens, man. Yeah. Awesome.
You mentioned
Soul Style for
me. Oh, hell yeah.
Let's crack another beer.
Why not, man?
Yeah.
You mentioned the Cellar 3, like, allowing you to kind of get into beer dinners and all that.
Yeah.
Do you have the privilege of being able to do that down here in Houston?
Sure. You know, I've done it before we had the Cellar 3 stuff. You know, every brewery's got some sort of specialty thing they do. But Cellar 3 just kind of is a reward for our cut. You getting it, man?
I'm going to get it before the end of this podcast.
It's going to be great. We'll have to celebrate when you do. Because you're fighting it hard, dude.
It's trying. It's testing me specifically.
Get over it.
I can't, bro. It's in my eye line.
Take a shower, bro. And I won't be around you.
Yeah, bro. I got you.
Yeah, man. So we it's a cool thing to give back to our great accounts out there that,
yeah,
you know, sell a lot of our beer. We want to show them some love. And, you know, really at the end of the day, that stuff costs a lot of money to make because yeah, it's, you know, we're sitting in barrels forever, you know. So it's like just sitting there. It's a product that you're not doing anything. So, yeah, but I mean, we try to give back to people and say, hey, you know, thanks for supporting us. Here's a really cool barrel-aged sour, you know,
exactly,
kind of thing. So, yeah, it's opened doors to cool things. I'm going to do something. I'm working on something with an account here that I'm going to do like 12 Cellar 3 beers at once with like a little flight. So
I got you. And then I don't know how much you're able to speak onto it, so I don't want to indict you too deeply. You guys have a collaboration with Rudyard? Or no, with...
We got one with Trader Joe's.
Trader
and we
Joe's.
Did one with Yard House. Yard House, they're both done. Trader Joe's, if you go there, there's a huge display. It's called 50, Fearless 50. They're 50 years old this year. They came to us and asked us to do a beer with them.
Okay.
And so we did, and it's just a Saison. It's real light. Got a little bit of spice to it. And then the Trader and then Yard House has become a really good partner of ours, and we did a beer called 3 Degrees of Celebration. It's a triple IPA. And their brewmaster, or our brewmasters, came up with it, and it's an Alpine as well. It's pretty damn good, and it'll be on tap all year at a Yard House, so you can go there and get it. There are no bottles available per se, but there you can definitely go to Yard House and ask.
They'll have that shit.
Yeah, it's legit.
That's what's up.
It's like 10%.
I got you.
So I'm good.
And then honestly, I feel like we've gotten all the information out of you as possible.
I've learned so much about beer.
Yeah, hey, that's what we aim to do. That's what we're trying to have the one person watching live right now learn is so much about beer.
That's right.
Yeah,
I'm about to go to all my friends, but man, you drinking shit.
It's right, go slap your beer. Come on, man.
That's that trash.
Well, here's the thing, though. We're American-owned. We're independent and American-owned. Like, support American breweries. Yeah, like, breweries like ourselves who are smaller that are not Budweiser, all these guys. I mean, that's a Belgian company owned in America. Like, that's what I'm saying. Like, let's support America, whether it's Texas local. These guys are... We're all trying to live the American dream, so to speak, and make money. Like, our Belgian overlords, man, get rid of those guys. I mean, they don't. It's not even American-owned anymore. Like, when they put America on their can, it made me so mad.
Oh, hell yeah,
man. They're not even American-owned anymore.
This is a phrase I definitely overused in the first, like, 10 episodes, and I'm going to bring it back because it is one of my favorites. But they were faking the funk.
Oh,
that's
like
not even
that.
American. I got to credit Carlos for teaching me that phrase, but it's one of my favorites now. They're not. And then phrase. Trump tried to take credit for it. I'm not going to get too deep on that. This isn't a political show. But, like... Get your heads out of your own asses, everyone. Yeah. like, how you mentioned, at the beginning of the show is where a couple of these can get you on, like, that buzz level. So it's like people kind of look at buying a six-pack or more of craft beer as like, oh, man, I'm spending maybe, like, $3 more, $2 more.
Yeah.
But then you think about it, and the investment pays off way more.
The analogy I
especially
use,
when you're tipsy off a couple of beers.
Yeah. So the analogy I use is like no disrespect to the Chili's franchise. We sell beer with them.
Yeah.
But here's the way I respect it. You can go to Chili's and get a steak. It'll be $15-16. It's probably not going to be cooked the way you want it. It's probably not going to be the best cut of meat. Or you can go like to a Ruth Chris and you pay a little bit more, high quality. It's going to be exactly the way you want it. And you pay a little bit more for it. Like that's kind of what craft beer is. Like you can go buy a cheaper version. It's going to be all right. Or you can step it up and pay a little bit more and get high quality stuff and get there fast. You know,
it's
kind of what.
And you're really not asking much more either.
And get lit.
like you're seeing a lot of breweries, especially when canning has become a huge part of a lot of breweries, like production.
Yeah.
And so it allows for more of it. And then also it seems to just drive the price a little bit down and everybody gets to kind of line price their beers.
Yeah.
And so it's not even like you're asking for like $5 more for a 12-pack. It's like it's like $150 or like $2.
But you know,
and I mean,
everybody's trying to stretch a dollar these days, and so I get that. And it's like, you know, those little things that you go to the store to pay for.
Yeah.
Like you want to pay a little bit extra for your beer because you know it's going to treat you right, kind of thing. And
if you care about yourself, at least.
Yeah, I mean that's why all that like freaking, you know, all the organic food and all that's so damn expensive, because it's like, you know, because they know you pay for it.
It's good for you.
Yeah, but it's good for you, you know? So.
Asparagus
yeah.
and water for like $15. That's what they had at
Whole Foods. Noodles, man.
Yeah.
Man.
And so,
I love ramen.
How could you not, though? Like,
it's every college kid, every person that's like struggling to pay bills at one point, like, that's the thing. You can get a whole meal. You know how many calories in that thing? It's like 2,000 calories in ramen. Like, you're good for a day.
Just
eat it midday and. I mean, if you end up hungry later, just remember you're broke and go to sleep.
My God, this motherfucker wants to live, dude.
Ramen and peanut butter.
Man. Ramen and peanut butter.
Whoa, what? You put peanut butter in your ramen?
And you make a peanut butter sandwich, man. You drain all the water out the ramen, man. You make it a little spread.
See, I always drain the Robert water out of it.
Good little spray.
I'm gonna have to try this.
If you can toast your bread.
Okay.
Eat your peanut butter and watch this. It's gonna, you're gonna be like, you know how like people make tomato soup with peanut butter or something? Like with
I didn't know that.
Bro, you're really opening my mind up with this peanut butter shit.
Yeah. How much do you like peanut butter? Because I love it.
I'm 240 some pounds. I love peanut butter.
That's fair.
I love all food, but peanut butter, you know, for a poor man.
Yeah. Peanut butter
is good stuff. Yeah, I mean, that's... Dude, I might try that. Cause, like,
We should have put a sock over
By
it.
By the way, that's Green Flash. Green Flash.
Everything. Have you ever taken the Tostinos or the Totitos pizzas, the little bit ones, and putting two together and made a sandwich out of it?
I've heard of people doing it, but I've not.
That's real.
Once we put we got a pizza and we put pizza rolls on the pizza.
Oh, y'all was high.
No.
What high as in? You know,
On life.
Just had a great day. You had a great day.
I had a great day.
Everyone makes mistakes.
Nah, I was definitely drunk though.
Hey, look, man. Yeah,
and they sunk in for the most part. They sunk into the pizza. It was pretty. It was actually only like a couple of them didn't sink in, so they
We've
didn't
been
act
called
as
worse, Johnny.
Mm-hmm. I mean, called worse. Look, I learned about this ramen peanut butter thing, man.
Yeah,
definitely try that. Now.
I'm on a diet and I'm still trying to eat it tonight.
And then I'm gonna tweet at you and be like, "You want mine, dude?"
Look, I'm gonna do it like this. Take your ramen, the chicken ramen.
Yeah.
Squeeze a little lemon on top of it.
Okay.
You know?
Yeah.
Put a little, one drop of hot sauce. Don't put a bunch. You put one drop. And it's going to be right. What the parents say, you're going to be right.
Dude, I'm going to do it. And I'm going to tweet at him and be like, bro.
So aside from all these ramen recipes, what's next to come for Green Flash and Alpine?
Sorry to get on a tangent, man.
Oh, no, man. That's what this shit's about.
So Alpine, we got a beer coming out in a couple, whenever TABC approves it, we're just waiting on registration. It was going to be called Hot Boxed, but now we're going to call it Windows Up.
So okay. Fair.
Get the reference.
Yeah.
Mosaic and Citra, 7%. It's a banging IPA. It's
yeah,
good.
There you go.
It's
that's
good. It's good. So that's coming. Alpine, Green Flash, we've got, you know, the GFB hitting next week. We've got our Belgian series of Cellar 3 coming out. We got Palette Wrecker coming back in February, so that's the...
Palette Wrecker is highly sought after.
Yeah, 9.5%, 138 IBUs. it'll tear your palate
It does
up.
Exactly what... Yeah, it comes 100% as advertised.
Yeah, so six packs of that finally. We used to do four packs, so now six packs and draft coming out in late February.
Man, y'all ignorant.
Yeah, man. So, and you know, we got a little bit of pure hoppiness still around the market, and we brought some tonight. You can try it.
Hell yeah.
But yeah, that's about it. I mean, we're keeping it... This year, we're going to keep it kind of mainstream, what we're doing. Reduce some SKUs, as we say, to not have so much beer out there and kind of mainline it where we're going to have what we do best and hopefully it works out.
I got you. Sounds good, man. Yeah. I guess we can get in on asking Johnny a shit ton of questions.
Oh, yeah.
In the meantime, what I was going to do is run to the bathroom and grab us some of those beers that we have in the
fridge. Get up real quick.
Yeah. Let's take a quick break before, you know, we come back to the questions so I can... You know, talk to y'all.
Like, oh, no, we're still live.
Oh,
we're still live than a motherfucker, bro. I'll talk to you, though, John.
Oh, for sure, man.
Johnny, bro, so when I was looking into your music videos, this is a great thing, and I told you about it earlier. The Jonny Bahama YouTube handle is taken. It's taken.
Yeah.
Hasn't been used in 6 or 7 years, but it's taken.
Was it Jonny too?
Yeah. Oh, yeah. I wouldn't bring it up unless it was dead on.
Damn.
And he has 60 to 70 videos about Yu-Gi-Oh cards.
Yu-Gi-Oh.
So, I was a big fan of Yu-Gi-Oh, and I watched a bunch of these videos, and it's like, you watch him basically go through puberty and get over Yu-Gi-Oh. And then he starts selling his cards.
Wow, bro.
You hear his voice deepens. I don't like Yu-Gi-Oh anymore.
That's not me.
So, is that, yeah, that's what I'm about to ask you. How much did you make off those cards, man?
Nah, that's not me, bro. I fucked the Pokemon for a little bit.
Yeah.
Like, I used to sell the little stickers at school. And then
no, you said the sharks, too. What was the shark one?
Which one?
You said the shark show. Like, there was
Street
Shark?
Oh, Street Shark.
Gargoyles.
Gargoyles, man.
Yeah.
Yeah, Gargoyles, that shit went hard. I fucked with that.
Yeah.
Yeah, that was that. Like, but yeah, not Yu-Gi-Oh. That, like, I'm from the Bahamas. They look at that shit like demons.
So that's where that comes from.
Sure. Yeah, they look at it. Like,
the Jonny Bahama.
Yeah. Oh, yeah. Jonny Bahama. My name is Jonathan.
Yeah.
You know, that's where I'm from. I'm from Fox Hill, and that's out Bahamas.
Okay, cool.
Yeah.
Shit, when's the last time you've been over there?
I ain't been back since I came.
Really?
Yeah, I ain't been back.
What's keeping you here? Or what's keeping you from there?
If I go back, I ain't gonna come back.
Okay.
I'm not gonna be able to come back here.
Oh, okay. It's just one of them.
You know, it's just just situation.
Yeah, exactly.
Just a situation that I gotta deal with, you know. Mm-hmm. But
get you some of that soul style real quick, man. You haven't had any of that.
It's
it's a little IPA.
This is lit. But I haven't been back to the Bahamas since I came down here. I came down here when I
was my man Garrett just brought a bunch of beer.
I got more, don't worry.
Let me get Garrett in here so I can get back on the microphone.
Thanks. Yeah, this Green Flash is awesome, by the way. Jonny Bahama fucks with Green Flash, like, officially, like, for real, bro. This
one
plug the hell in. So all my people out there, y'all try to go find Green Flash. I'm telling y'all right now.
The Born Smokes spokesperson, man. Yeah, man. Get you endorsement deals.
Go ahead and take care of that. So we were at Bloomfest, bro. We were at Bloomfest, and you got inducted into EGP, right?
Yeah. Shout out EGP. I've been fucking with them the partners, man. Shout out Tim Woods.
Did you know before that you were getting, like, they squared it away?
I pressed them a few times years back, and I was like, man, rock with me, when you're doing music, when you're doing music and stuff like that, you don't want to kind of fully just be by yourself doing this. You need a team. And doing this type of shit, not like I peeped what the Ramirez brothers was doing.
Yeah.
And like I was reaching out to them. They had other artists at the time, they had like Bazooka Low and Rocky Banks and Freddie Ng and Tim Woods. They had like a whole camp.
Yeah.
But they kinda kept running with Tim, and Tim's doing his thing. Shout out to Tim Woods again.
One time.
And it kept doing his thing, and I kinda tried to keep in Tori's ear. I got a couple people that know him, and they keep my name in his ear. And kind of like towards later in 2016, they told me that they was fucking with me a little bit, and that, we were chopping it up. And, he had put me on with the Bloomfest, and, I kind of joked to him. I was like, what I'm saying? He told me he was fucking with me. I joked to him, was like, man, you need to make it official.
Yeah.
You know what I'm saying? So, like, hey, I did it at the show, and it was lit, I'm EGP now,
When I called him, I told him, I really like, we're talking about TJ. Right. I told him, I really like Villain Posse. He told me all about Villain Posse.
Yeah.
And he's like, you like Jonny Bahama? Right. And I was like, yeah, I fuck with Jonny Bahama. He's like, he's up next. I can't tell you everything, but he's up next, bro.
He told me that, man, and that's kind of the mindset I'm going to try to keep. I'm up now. Type,
Gotta stay hungry. Cool. I like that.
I'm up now. I just gotta. It's all about the consistency.
You got a lot of singles out too. Are these all going towards a project, or are they just loose singles right now?
Singles, man. I kind of got all the singles out the way without doing songs with with my family. I had a lot of songs with Dino. Shout out Dino. That's my little brother, my blood brother.
Okay.
Do a lot of songs. I did a lot of songs with them. I did a lot of songs by myself. I did a lot of songs with Pound of Black Rab and my Pound of Caddy G.
Hey, one time. One time for Caddy G.
Yo.
I did a song with, I did a song with Pyrex I never released. I did a song with,
Okay.
So you got something locked up in the vault we don't even know about yet.
Nah, I ain't dropping them. Okay. I got a lot of songs with a lot of people.
I got
but
you.
But I'm not, a lot of people that, a lot of people be bullshitting, not saying Pyrex. But Pyrex is a more of a gospel thing now, And I feel like,
putting him out there like that.
Yeah.
They haven't hit. I got you.
You know what I'm saying? So it's just.
Because, you're not on your gospel shit right now.
No, I've been giving God fully, but I'm not on no gospel
shit.
Nah,
I feel you.
I'm not preaching the word.
You know what I'm saying? I mean, you're preaching your word, but.
Yeah, preaching the real shit, but not like that. But
I feel you.
I've been
dropping singles for a while.
Yeah, for real. I like your style, though, man. Like you have a couple styles that kind of, like, blend together, Like, you're aggressive, but you're smooth, you know what I'm saying? You can slow it down.
Yeah.
And you can kind of sing, too.
I've always been in choir and stuff like that. I love music. I figured that was the closest way to keep into music, being in choir, being in church. I did. When I was younger in the Bahamas, I was very involved in church a lot. So I was in the choir there,
Yeah.
All the girls was in choir in school. So, it was a place to be.
Yeah.
But being aggressive, just like you said, bro, I, I never got to, you know, be in choir and be in school. And actually, I was always in M.R. Woods. Or
Shouts out to M.R. fucking Woods.
Fuck them niggas. Fuck them. Hell no. Nah, but.
Yeah, no, shout out to Negative for my man.
Yeah. I did not mean that whole
M.R. Woods, eat a dick.
Yeah, no, so I never get to be. I probably would have been a way better singer, you know?
Yeah.
But my girl, my wife, she kind of helps me clean up. I'm cleaning up my voice more.
Yeah. Because
I want to kind of, like, step into that lane.
Start smoking
more.
Papers.
No. It don't get me loaded. Nah, I can't do that. But yeah, a lot of my songs is kind of more smoother. A lot of my aggressive rap, you know, I'm saving that for when Sway hit me up.
Yeah.
You know? And then they'd be like, you know, you be singing, but I'm like, nah, you know.
Well, you get that in some of your earlier songs that, like, you could tell you were, like, really eating, like, you were hungry, getting out there, trying to, like, get heard with your aggressiveness, but at the same time, like how you said, it's a smooth aggressive now, whereas, like, the beats slap, like, there's no question about that, but then you just carry it where you'll be 2 minutes into a song, and you're like, he really hasn't, like, spit at me, but, like, bars have been said, and, it's all come together very well, and so... You're not bullshitting, that's for sure.
No bullshit at all. I feel like it flows like that. I've been writing music for a long time, way before, you know, I actually knew way before I even listened to rap. I grew up on rock and roll and reggae.
Yeah.
You know.
Who are your rock and roll icon?
Oh my God, man, I love Journey, I love
Eagles,
I love Bob Seger, I love Eric Clapton, I like a lot of smooth shit. But I also love, you know, AC/DC, even though I don't really like them too much.
They go left and right with good or bad, I feel like.
I like a lot. I love Bob Marley. I love, you know, Buju Banton. I love Shabba Ranks. I love a lot of, you know, a lot of different music that people wouldn't, you know.
Yeah.
Think I
wouldn't pin on you.
Yeah. But when I moved to the States, like, Eminem was already in the Bahamas, you know, huge. But when I moved to the States, man, I started getting, like, put onto like just only rap, because you know you didn't have no reggae stations here, and the classic rock station playing the same, like, my hours, I'm already tired of that, and and Green Day and all of them not clicking to me so
music went through a weird phase like early to mid 2000s.
I was talking about it earlier.
Everything could be pop.
I really like the 90s music. Like what it took from the 80s and how it's subculture from that. But I think I think it died after like 2003. That's when music started getting weird.
All boy bands and whatnot.
And like it's something they've been doing in music
when
for
was
a
Hot
while.
In Here, man?
Like,
after Hot in Here. Everything was downhill after Hot in Here.
That was what, 2006?
Sounds about right, yeah.
Maybe, I was going to say maybe even earlier. But like,
my dog died from Nelly.
I mean that. Like, that was Nelly.
One time for Nelly.
I used to put band-aids on my face, man.
Yeah. One time I got scratched in football. Like someone like put their fucking fingers through my shit. And everyone thought, like, oh, yeah, that band-aid is a Nelly. I was like, nah, man.
Nah, life's rough.
I'm not biting Nelly like that.
Scratched.
Yeah. This is real. Like, I'm not. There's no facade.
No scratch.
Foil on my teeth. And fucking.
The foil on the teeth.
Foil on the teeth, bro.
I knew what the hell I wanted to do way early. My mom used to, like, get so mad. She'd be like, don't glorify that type of stuff, boy. You know, and like. Okay.
When did you know school wasn't for you, though? Like,
School ain't never been for me. Going to school, like, I went to public school in the Bahamas, and it was like, you know, I'm Hispanic and Black. I in a country where everyone is all Black, so you know they call me now, like, y'all are white.
Yeah.
You're Hispanic, right?
That was almost two times.
But you would go to the Bahamas and you're white.
I'm white.
I'm Black and Hispanic, but I'm white.
Yeah.
So but my mother is Black. I'm talking about Black.
Yeah.
So I get mad. I fight a lot. So I never liked school. I moved to here to the States. People like, take your Jamaican ass back to the Bahamas. So I ain't want to be in school.
That's Americans' favorite thing to say, though, is go back anywhere. If you're
blank,
Jamaica, Bahamas,
ignorance, though.
It's just straight ignorance.
Yeah, you know, he got punched. It's all good.
He went back where he came from.
Suckers get punched, bro.
It's all good. But, you know, school ain't that. I went to school in Missouri City. You know, it was involved with a lot of stuff I shouldn't be involved in. Never was in school. Went to school, moved to Conroe, was in sports, was doing good, you know. Got into a fight, stopped going to school. So I tried to go back to school after the supposed to graduate, you know. Went to school, literally answered a question in the class. Teacher made fun, was like, oh, you should already know that. You're supposed to graduate already. Yeah. So I tried to beat boy up. There's no more school for me.
Yeah.
So, you know, I'm still on that route to get my diploma. I ain't gonna lie. School ain't never been for me.
Yeah.
I'm a grown man with a child and a wife. I don't have a diploma. Fuck school.
Yeah.
Chase your dreams. If you're intelligent enough, people will never know you didn't.
It's all about real world experiences.
Exactly.
You know?
That's so. The thing is, like, there is such a thing as being knowledgeable, but like the idea of being smart, I've been thinking about a lot lately, where smart is just accessing information.
Yeah. Mm-hmm. Information. Yeah. Too. Yeah.
And trust me, there are learning disabilities and there are things that like do get in the way of some people, but at the same time, you can put your ass to the fucking grindstone and just
do anything.
Yeah.
And you can like not fuck with school, and like you can be smart.
Yeah.
And not like be smart in something completely different.
Self-educate yourself. Yeah. And things like that.
You can be smart.
Man, I didn't go to school, man, and I can walk anywhere in the city and everybody know what I'm doing and
yeah,
know what it is that I'm doing and support, you know, what it is that I'm doing.
Yeah.
And I probably will never go to school, but I guarantee you, I'm gonna end up richer than 90% of the kids that don't remember my name. You know what I'm saying?
Hey.
See, I think that's one of the good stereotypes that's actually dying, is the fact that if you don't go to school, you don't go to college.
Yeah.
It's like, you're not going to be anything. I think that's a good stereotype that's ending, because, you know, there's a lot of people that in our industry or other industries that don't get a degree. But when I was, you know, I'm a little older, but when I was raised, it's like, oh, you got to graduate high school, you got to go to college, do this. And like, now you don't really have to. You can still be successful. I know lots of CEOs of major companies that didn't go to college.
Yeah.
And some of them didn't even finish high school, and they're billionaires. Like, it happens. So it's okay. Yeah. You know? I think it's a good stereotype that's dying, because school's not for everybody. You're right, man. So like, there's nothing wrong with that.
That's like you said, it's about your grind, man. Like, what your company, what you're doing right now. Yeah. You didn't go to school for that.
No,
you played. Exactly. You played ball in college.
Yeah, right? I played football in college.
And look at
it. And I was wanting to do this radio. And
you see,
it helps me talk. That's about it. But yeah. I didn't learn how to sell beer. I just got into beer. You know,
exactly.
And you didn't learn how to write music. You just started doing it, and then you know.
I think a lot of people started realizing on the school tip where like, you hear a lot of people like doing a career and it has nothing to do with their degree.
Oh, yeah.
And it's all because there are, everyone, like, I don't want the message here to be don't go to school.
Yeah,
it's the idea.
Stay in school, kid.
Yeah. School.
Most people take their degree as like, that's what they're going to do if they can't do what they want to do.
And
definitely right now, that's how I see it. That's how a lot of my people are.
Bro, right now I'm trying to get a degree just so I can say I have a piece of paper that certifies, like, and it's Always Sunny in Philadelphia, I don't have donkey brain.
It says you can go to class, you can complete something. That's really
That's exactly what it is. It shows that you have the attention span to finish something in the real world.
Exactly.
I'm not going to want to, I mean, I know these things. My grandmother is a lawyer.
Yeah.
You know what I'm saying? My wife's in school.
Yep.
You know what I'm saying? My sister's nurse's aide. Like, I know for a fact that, you know, school is very important. I want people to go to school. You know, I think school is very important. It's essential. But, you know, if you have work ethic, that's all a part. That's a part.
Yeah,
of
we live school. In a great time for that.
And
that's
exactly.
And that's something also that we've talked about on the show is like restructuring how we teach kids stuff.
Yeah,
exactly.
Just because so many things have changed just in the last 10 years,
kids in school,
let alone the last 20.
More what they want to learn about. Instead of being forced to certain
kind of like trade schools like they do in Europe, where you know, again, not to get political, I think that's what some other candidates were talking about, was like, you know, look, if you want to be a mechanic, you should be able to go to school for free to that.
Yeah.
You know, if you want to do something different, well, then you may have to pay for it. But like, that's what they have in Europe. They have trade schools and things like that, where guys that want to be, you know, writers or whatever get to go to trade school and it's paid by the government. Like, that's legit.
Dope.
Yeah. And see, there's ways to do that and support like your entire country of people, like because everyone's not the most creative person in the world.
No.
Everyone can't rap like Jonny Bahama.
I couldn't do what he does. No,
and like,
not.
Shit, we can hardly host a radio show. So, but it's like, what I've been telling people, just based on doing this, I'm like, look, if you just have the idea, at least follow through and like put the hard work that goes into following
hard
through.
Hard work can't be ignored.
No, and it won't be ignored.
And it's not going to produce nothing. But if you produce nothing with just an idea, and then 3 years later you look back and like,
and you're sitting in the same place.
Exactly.
Go get it, man.
Yeah.
Like you said, go get it.
It's all about
we got fucking deep, Jonny.
Philosophical.
Everybody got fucking deep. Everyone took a turn, girl. It was like the That 70s Show smoker circle.
That's what these couches were for.
That's what interviews should feel like, man.
Yeah.
You know, people just like, well, so I
so I watched your video the other day.
Yeah. Like, you probably didn't, man.
30 seconds.
Watch the video, bro.
Nah, man.
We also watch other Jonny Bahama.
On a few outlets, you're being called the most slept-on rapper, a Houston rapper of last year.
I seen that on a couple of...
How do you plan on waking people up, man?
Man, I let them fucking stay asleep.
Yeah.
They don't stay asleep. I've always been a type. I try to stay in my own lane. So, when people see it, you know... The internet is one thing, man. I'm not no brainiac. I don't have no management. I don't know how to,
You said your family is your management, right?
Yeah, my sister works for me. My wife.
Yeah.
My mother-in-law sometimes, you know. My brother.
Yeah.
My friends. You know, that's about it. I have a strong support system in real life, So, things on the internet, that's a lot of people look at things on the internet.
Yeah.
You know, but we pack out a show. Jonny gonna pack out a show. We threw a Halloween party, not last year, but the year before last, we had 300 plus people.
Yeah.
You know, and that's just off of,
had the crowd lit?
On the net, what you mean, man? Mm-hmm. We're gonna always turn it up. We broke the city. We break stages, man.
There we go.
Literally, man. We break stages.
Bloomfest was a really good, opportunity for me to see that, because I think it's something that's been going on for a while now. It's been, how you just said, people know that Jonny shows up, Johnny's gonna break a stage. Like, shit's gonna pop. And so... Yeah.
Bloomfest,
it was like,
I'm not even gonna lie, bro. Bloomfest, I didn't even finish my set, and people really didn't even know it. DJ DJ messed me up a little bit.
Oh, really?
Yeah, man.
I got you.
I'm an emotional motherfucker, so I kind of was just like, I'm gonna just finish this one off and get off stage.
Hispanic,
I got you.
Yeah,
it's that heat.
So I was like, let me get the fuck off stage before I look like the person I don't want to look like.
Yeah. Hey, it's good that you had the mind to at least catch that.
Yeah, I conduct myself right there, man.
I got you. And so it's nice to see that, there are people just in the surrounding area of Houston that it's like they support something small right now. Or, Walters was pretty packed, but it's also that could be a big-ass show.
Oh, yeah.
And people could turn the fuck up, man. The whole set list, I've been telling people when they ask how it was, I'm like, you should have come, because, set list.
It was like a legit show.
Yeah.
We could do it again. And
very much so.
EGP, we're going to keep doing it.
Oh, yeah.
It's going to be nonstop. We're going to keep doing it.
I know
we have a lot of things lined up.
And like you said, you're a big proponent of staying in your own lane.
Yeah.
What makes you? What do you think makes people veer from their own lane? Like, how do they get out of their own lane? Why is that such a hard concept for people?
Friends, bro.
Friends.
Only seeing fucking friends, bro. Trying to fit in. Like, I know me. I always loved music, but at a time period when I was fitting, I tried to fit in. It'd be a lot of shit. You gotta be tough. Depending around who you put yourself around.
Yeah.
I put myself around people. They hit the block. I necessarily didn't have to hit the block. My parents did good enough. It was Walmart clothes. I didn't want Walmart clothes.
Yeah.
I wanted Jordans. Yeah. So it all depends on who you put yourself around. Trying to fit in. That's how you step out of your own lane. And then stepping out of your own lane, you gotta conduct yourself a certain way. So you end up doing shit that is probably not you in nature.
Yeah.
Like me, I'm a kind-hearted person. I consider myself smooth, but you ask anybody, I've been in zillions of fights.
Yeah.
There's zillions of situations that be like, if you know me, be like, man, that's not Jonathan, but it happened. Because I'm stepping out of my frame, out of my own lane, out of not doing what I really should be doing as who I am as an individual.
Yeah.
You know what I'm saying? So I try to step down as an older man, as a man now. Trying to stay in my own lane, stay alive.
You said stepping out of your lane almost got you killed, huh?
Yeah, man. Stepping out of my lane has got me fucked up. Plenty of times, jump, shot.
Yeah.
Fucking beat up, have detectives knocking on my mom's door, people pointing lasers in my little sister's room, getting shot at in front of my people.
Yeah.
Shooting at people in front of my people, fighting a lot, a lot of fighting.
Yeah.
A lot of fighting, bro, getting my little sister jumping in the fights because niggas jumping me in the schoolhouse. Just stupid shit.
Yeah.
Literally moving different schools because I can't keep my ass out of the heat.
Yeah.
And that's not Jonathan. And I say Jonathan because that's me. You know what I'm saying? So, you stay in your own lane and you could do great things. You step out of your lane, you could be a dead motherfucker.
You lose that focus. Yeah,
you can lose your focus real fast.
Yep.
You know what I'm saying? you lose a lot of good friends along the way and end up with friends that you think friends and them just some envious motherfuckers. You find out at the end of the day they're
along for the ride.
They're along for the ride. That's the perfect word. They're along for the ride. And see how long you keep doing what you're doing.
So. Use you till you don't need you.
Yeah, that's how they exactly.
Yeah, that no more. That's some shit that's hot right now.
Oh yeah,
not in a good way, but
that's a popular trait.
Yeah,
a leech motherfucker.
Yeah. Reality TV's got these people acting just retarded.
Athletes, you see with artists.
Stupid.
It's
ridiculous. Yeah. Oh yeah, you see some of those, like with athletes, like what you see is a lot of them. They finish their career and you're like, man, they must be rich. And it's like, no, they've got family on payroll. They've got family's friends on payroll.
30 for 30 called broke. You got guys like Travis Hinder who had, you know, like seven kids or whatever, but he had like $45,000 a month in child support and like things like that. But he mismanaged his money. You know, he trusted the wrong uncle or whatever. And it's just sad because, man, these guys.
Staying his lane.
See, and it's just, it's sad because, man, you know, it, once it's over, you know?
Yeah.
The money not going to come again, bro.
That's right.
You said he was in the NFL.
Yeah, Travis Hinder.
Not for
back.
Long, nigga.
Yeah, nah, that's what it means. That's what it means.
Not for long.
Yeah.
No way, nah.
So, you recently just had a baby, right?
Yeah, I had a baby about 2 months ago.
There we go. What has fatherhood taught you in these 2 months? Something that you didn't expect, like, something that you weren't woke to yet, like
that a woman can do anything.
Yeah,
a woman can play the role of a man, but the man can't play a role of a woman.
Yeah,
that's what it's taught me. I'm gonna be real. I would get into it with my mother-in-law a lot, you know, cause she wanted me to do better, and I still had the mind frame of an ignorant person.
Yeah.
I ain't gonna say it, nigga. Of an ignorant person.
Yeah.
And, you know, and kind of stepping back and watching how my son's mother and her stepped into just like I don't know, bro. It's like, I don't even know, bro. It's like, it taught me how to hold him. It taught me when he hungry. It taught me when, if he the fussing, he might not be hungry, he just got pee. Like, just little things off of signs, like, just from watching them. Like, you know what I'm saying? Like, I walked in the room with him and his grandmother yesterday, and they was listening to Boys to Men.
Yeah.
And she Hispanic. So, like, that makes me happy, you know what I'm saying? Like, fatherhood just taught me a lot how to love and appreciate family more and to appreciate my woman more and to kind of, like, appreciate my life more. Like, I feel like a lot of points in my life, I didn't really care about my own life. I still, you know, getting to them points, but I look at my son and he, like, it's a cool little motherfucker.
That's little you.
Yeah.
I like that.
Saint that's baby, I ain't worried about him.
Yeah, so it's cool. His fatherhood has been awesome.
Get that baby a record deal, right?
I want to be a DJ or a boss or a mathematician or
Whatever makes him happy.
I don't know, bro. Whatever you want to do.
Yeah.
I just want him to play football.
That's fair.
True that.
Dangerous.
Football, bro. I play football.
Dangerous.
Basketball.
So, do you have any dream collaborations, man, that you'd love to do?
I want to do an album with my wife.
Uh-oh, there we go. The one time you don't ask this type of question.
Oh, man, I had that loaded. Don't worry.
There we go.
I was going to say, y'all beat Tim and Lita to the punch on having the kid. So you're already 2 steps ahead. You're married and have a child. So this is the lead Houston couple.
Tim and Lita going to be on that way. Son, you watch. You know,
little Blasian babies.
They sweet. They cool. I like their relationship, man. They real cool.
Can we expect an album from you too, right here?
Yeah, definitely. We're working on a single right now. We're not going to put a name to it yet, but we got some things in the works. She got an album coming out in March too. And so, you know, she's been working hard on that, her and her producer. And James as much. I'm sorry, May. I think. I'm just nitpicking.
Spitballing.
So, yeah. But we got definitely probably gonna have an album together. I'm definitely this year I'm dropping the late start. I'm gonna just go ahead and say it. I'm not gonna say a date, but I'm dropping the late start this year, so
it's called Late Start.
Yeah, no dream collaborations, bro. I'm not that. I don't know, bro. I stay in my lane.
Yeah,
you know.
That's fair.
Buju Bantan, that would be dope. You know what I'm saying?
There we go.
A song Buju Bantan. You know, it'd be dope to do a song with Lil Boosie. I do a song with Lil Boosie. That'd be dope as fuck. If I could do a song with Webby, that'd be dope.
Wipe me down.
if I could get signed by T.I., that'd be dope. I love T.I., bro. I fuck with T.I., bro. I like...
What song puts you on to T.I.?
No song? Ain't about music when you respect the man.
Yeah.
Bro, you know what I'm saying?
Okay.
It's about how he carry himself, mm-hmm. how he act, how he conduct himself, you know what I'm saying? And music, I couldn't even name you a T.I. song right now. Like, just be like, yep, this T.I. song.
Yeah.
I could name more probably Kevin Gates songs because, like, when I got hip to him, I listened to him, so I had to, you know, look it up.
Yeah.
Yeah.
I probably named you more, Eminem songs, so I can name you T.I. songs, but just T.I. he conducts.
So you're a big Eminem fan.
It's actually kind of.
Fuck with him, bro.
It's hard not to. I mean,
I fuck with him.
More later music.
Like, M is the reason I was brave enough to punch motherfuckers, bro.
That's
like,
fair.
Straight up, like M, like I just be like, okay. That kid not gonna
you know, I think I got into a lot of fights. I never thought about it that way, but I'm pretty sure I got into a lot of fights because of Eminem. Not because of me, but probably just because I had someone else like
oh, yeah.
Yeah, I can fight this person. Like, that's not a good feeling for everybody. Not everyone should have that feeling.
Eminem will help you embrace your ass whooping, too. Even you lose, you you'd be like, you know what?
You know what? I sucked up. That time.
Yeah,
that but time. I'm still hard.
That's the thing. You don't know how to fight until you got your ass kicked.
True.
That's true.
You ask me one, you know how to. I got a question, man. Like, how this scene is very competitive. Like, what's it? I mean, how competitive is it? Like, is it? I mean, it's a grind. I know, but like, you know, kind of let me know because I'm not hip to the scene. I'm not in it all the time. But like, I know there's a reputation.
You stopped rapping years ago.
Yeah, I stopped years ago, man.
It's competitive, bro.
DJ Samples.
Like, look at it this way: you have a lot of people that's trying to do what you do, right. Do what you love. On top of you have to start putting yourself out there.
Yeah.
So you have to, you know, take chances with your heart if you really love this music.
Yeah.
And not to mention if you have a face card, you start getting more popular. Mm-hmm. There's the hate that comes along with it.
Sure.
There's the envy that come along with it. There's the old beefs that come along with it. In this industry nowadays, it's just the truth. Mm-hmm. You know, people like to bring up that type of things because you know all they got to do is pull out their camera and jump Jonny. And get views and they get ha-ha about it.
Well, it's like you said, like, you got in a fight or whatever, like, some dude that from a long time ago be like, oh, man, he's a punk, and then, like, just start talking trash.
Yeah, you can't worry about that. Someone could watch this right now and be like, nah, hell nah, that boy a hoe, fuck him, you know what I'm saying?
Yeah. But you can't listen to that, though, right?
Yeah, it's a lot of different reasons, there's a lot of different things that make this shit competitive. Like, money.
Yeah.
Money make it competitive, bro. I'm not rich. I don't have a manager.
Yeah.
You know, I'm on a label, but I don't have my own manager. I got people that rock with me. You know what I'm saying? That try their best to put me on in different lanes as best as they can. But you still gotta pay for blogs if blogs ain't fucking with you. You still gotta pay a videographer who gonna spend their time editing their videos.
Yeah.
If I don't, I have people like Southside. I fuck with Southside Collection.
Fuck with Jonny Bahama. That's weird.
You know what I'm saying? You got people that like this type of stuff where I can interview, you know what I'm saying?
Sure.
But then if not, they, you know, I gotta, you know, you wanna get that exposure, you gotta pay somebody to do that.
Yeah.
And that's money. That's
spending more money than you're making, man. That's,
and
yeah.
And you gotta record your music.
Yeah.
At one point, I was very connected to this one blog, and they were talking about it. It was like this really big like underground blog, and then they separated. Like, the team separated because one half was more about charging people to be on the blog, and the other half was just about
finding people.
So like, they broke into two separate blogs. Mm-hmm. And now one is still there, and it was the one that kept it real. People can pay to be on here, but like, if you want
real survives,
they make that money, they stay their lane. Once again, you stay your lane,
yeah,
the money will come because the right people will see what you're doing and they'll want to invest. You know what I'm saying? The right people will come along if you be the right person and you stay in line.
I think that's been a common theme, honestly, throughout our episodes.
Too, yeah,
it's literally like, even on the beer side of things, people, it's always just do what you like and do it well, and just come genuine about it.
Grimy businesses, like saying women can't craft beer.
Yeah, women. It's yeah.
That,
it's,
and then even like product to product, you could be
regional,
like,
it's
yeah,
just, you know, and it's crazy. People bash
it's
just like
dog
that.
Dog world, period.
Yeah,
you know?
Yeah.
So why are you calling the project Late Start?
Because it's a late start, man.
There we go. That's what I wanted to say.
That's a late start, bro.
Yeah. People, why are you starting so late?
Man, you know, I want to know something? I never wanted to put out a project that wouldn't do what I know Johnny can do.
Yeah.
You know, I could drop a tape for y'all right now. Tonight y'all put on 7 beats.
Yeah.
You know what I'm saying? But what's it gonna do?
Yeah.
Get Kang on the phone.
You know what I'm saying?
Yeah.
So but I could keep dropping these nice singles where you ain't gonna never forget it. Every time you hear it, you're gonna know this Johnny.
Yeah.
Until like the right people see me. And then when the right people are behind me, then you know it. Not, but now the right people behind me. Shout out EGP.
Hey,
I'm gonna drop a little EP. You know, the late start will be my first little official EP.
Yeah.
And then after that, then who knows? Maybe a mixtape.
The world, so, Chico, and everything in it.
Yeah, hey, I want it all. I want it all, minus the bullets.
There you go.
True.
You feel me?
And then, did you ever play the Scarface game?
Nah, bro, I don't do that. I don't 2K. Man.
No, this is old. This is like,
it was terrible. None of Xbox, right?
None of us.
It was. I liked it.
My mom didn't like shooting stuff, bro.
My mom didn't games. Either. My dad bought me them hoes.
I ended up falling in love with the real things.
My dad bought me them hoes, and my mom would give him some shit afterwards. Like, how could you buy him this? He's shooting people.
Why
he
bought it?
I had to go to friends' house to play GTA because it was literally just being talked about on the news.
When I grew up, like, I had to hide my Bone Thugs tape.
Mind you, tape.
I said tape.
And Warren G, I had to hide it from my mom because she's just like, I don't want you those words they say.
Yeah, it's true.
But so I had to hide it because
it's reasonable now that you think about it.
You some gangster shit.
Yeah, when I heard Bone, you grow up in suburbs, it's like, man, this is fucked up, but it's
there's
awesome.
Real stuff out there.
Yeah.
My dad's limit was Tipsy by Jake Wong. He heard it. Wow. Why are you listening to this? People getting drunk. Are you getting drunk? Was, oh, here it comes.
Y'all remember Joe?
Like, no, 12. This is a really good song.
He watches your podcast. And
yeah.
Do you remember Tipsy? The guy just.
I wasn't drinking at the time. Joe.
There's a guy just named Joe. Oh yeah, I was gonna ask.
Pop a bottle.
I'd like for you to do the honors of describing this, so I don't just butcher it for you.
So this beer is called Blank Tart Barrique.
Yeah.
It is a sour blonde ale aged in red wine and white wine barrels.
Ooh.
It's a little dry. A little fancy, a little sour.
And what's the ABV on this one?
This is like our version
4.5.
Of Dom or Cristal here. There you go.
Man, I'll tell you this much, man. This has been a lit podcast. I've been here learning about alcohol, drinking alcohol.
Did I mention drinking alcohol?
Can I mention that?
Because,
you know,
did
you hear me? I'm not
high.
Yeah,
please. There we go. Johnny, now that you're about to turn it on us, man, what happened to you turning it on us?
You know, I got so wrapped the conversation.
You said you wanted to talk to Samson.
I wanted to talk to Samson. Whatever else the motherfucker say after that shit. Nah, but, alright, you know, we're going to flip this shit. We're going to flip this real quick.
You want to drink something?
You know what I'm saying? Southside Collection.
Yeah.
We're going to flip this real quick.
Fuck! Go ahead.
Let's do this damn thing. We interviewing y'all now.
Okay.
All right. Tell me why.
Tell me why.
Tell me why. Nah, I don't even know. Tell me why.
We were all inspired.
You know, the brew thing, like, what made y'all kind of, what made y'all even start doing this in the first place?
Man, him and I had this idea for, like, 2 years now.
Right.
And, honestly, we just get drunk together and talk about it. Like, we just be at a bar and be drinking.
Good.
Yes.
Good as fuck. I think everyone's going to sip, like, at the same time.
A little fucker, it's a little sour, it's not too much.
And not all up in your face, but enough.
I would drink good. I'm sorry.
See? I can drink pickle juice, but I got where you're going. This is kind of a little bit like a little vinegar, a little sour.
Yeah,
this is really good.
We literally just drank all the time together. And then we were like, we should do a podcast where we drink. And what else do we like? We like music.
We would get drunk and literally, I have it on my phone, I think, still, notes of like just us asking each other, like, all right, if you could see 5 artists perform live in the world, all right, if you could see a duo, and they don't have to already be an existing duo, just like people that collaborate on songs, who would you see? And so, like, we realize, oh, we just get drunk and can talk to each other. Like, we're not just out to turn up. We're just, it helps. It lubricates the conversation. And, like, if other people join, it just becomes better, like, a more fun time.
Yeah.
And so,
pretty much just ran with the normal topic of conversation.
Yeah. We noticed what we were always talking about.
We talked today, and I was like, literally, he was asking me about the questions and stuff. I was like, literally, we're going to get.
Yeah,
drink,
you know,
and it's gonna flow.
I called him earlier, man. I was like, look, hey, am I gonna be blindsided by him? Y'all gonna make me bring up my, like, do y'all know a little extra about me?
No, we're not trying to.
This ain't Nardwar, bro.
We're not trying to Katie Couric it.
You know what I'm saying? But like, I did not want, like, people to be sitting outside the doors waiting for me.
Nah, man, we do our due diligence as far as, like, researching and, like, getting together and talking about what we want to discuss. But, like, I even mentioned it with you, Josh. I was like, look, these are the things that I would like to come up. There's a chance all of them don't get spoken or spoken about, or like other things just come up because that's just how our conversation happens.
Right. It's pretty good flow, man. Yeah,
I appreciate that. It's more you're someone who actually knows.
Like, laid back.
Yeah.
And everyone likes drinking.
Not buttoned up interview, you know?
Yeah.
Mostly.
Like, and so, like, my main thing was I never wanted to be corny about it. Like, like, we talked, we were like, we could do like an hour to 1.5 hours max, but it's like, man, fuck it. If it goes 2 hours, like, obviously, we're not going to gain everybody's listening, like, from one episode on 2 hours, but I'd rather fucking hang out with y'all for 2 hours, and then there's recordings of it, and if people fuck with it, they fuck with it.
What's the end game? Like, just do it and see where it goes kind of thing, and, if, you know, if it doesn't take off, then whatever, we're going to keep doing it. If it does, then awesome.
I mean,
keep doing it.
Yeah, for sure.
I think we're going to keep
doing
this thing.
As long as people want to sit where you're sitting, and they want to tell us what it is they do and how they do it and what makes them want to do it, bro, I want to hear it. You know,
exactly. I think you're doing a good thing. You're promoting both walks of life, and then you're getting things out there for people, and you're gonna help people come up, and then it's gonna be one of those things where they're like, hey, you gotta sit on this podcast.
Like,
who would have thought it'd been a musician or a brewery company?
That's what I love.
And sometimes we have like breweries come on, and then they listen to the artist before they come on. Like, who's gonna be here?
Yeah. Oh, he gonna love Johnny.
I'm gonna listen to it. Don't worry.
He gonna go on to the wife and be like, you gotta listen to him.
What's that?
I'm gonna listen to it.
We'll play some after this for sure. If you've got time, I know you've got a wife at home.
I'm down to listen, man.
Well, you want to do some plugs and get out of here?
Let's plug and get out of here.
Who wants to plug first?
Go,
man. Plug. Shout out. Is somebody doing shout outs right now?
Where to find
shout
you
EGP,
and.
You know, shout out to the
social media. Where to find you?
You have any shows?
You can find me at official Jonny Bahama on Instagram at official Jonny Bahama, JONNY Bahama. Twitter Jonny_Bahama. On Facebook at Jonny Bahama. You know, Jonny Bahama everywhere. JONNY Bahama.
Love that, shout out EGP.
Right,
show's coming up.
Love that name.
I really wasn't expecting a hard ass rapper whenever I saw Jonny Bahama on, and then I wasn't expecting it to be some motherfucker I went to middle school and high school with.
I did go to school.
Shit was wild.
I saw him. I was like, bro, that's a dude playing sports. I remember that much.
And it continues to prove Lita Styles right that somehow I went to school with everybody.
Yeah,
like we're at.
But it's the Missouri City area. It's something in the water,
bro.
Yeah.
Something in the water.
I'm not even gonna count myself as one of the talents coming out of there because I'm not talented at anything. But we've got so many motherfuckers coming out of Missouri City right now. Like, people don't understand. We might have a Super Bowl candidate in Jake Matthews.
Yes, man.
I'm telling you right now. I had a dream of it last night. I saw it, Patriots Falcons. All right.
I can see it happening. Right, as long as the Patriots are there.
Yeah, I mean, I don't know. We win that game with the Falcons, like we talked about earlier. Like, they're kind of underrated. Don't sleep on the Falcons.
Matt Ryan.
Before we go,
Wait.
You have to pick your Super Bowl one person, one team.
The Giants.
No. This
year.
Now.
I don't care.
The Giants are still going to win.
Right now, they're going to win. That's going to win the Super Bowl.
Yeah.
Falcons are going to win the Super Bowl.
Falcons are going to win the Super Bowl.
All right. Jamal Anderson. How's it go? Remember that?
I forget. I remember it, but I was,
you guys a little
I was young as it happened. I'm more Mike Vick 04 Madden Falcons fan.
Oh, my God.
When they made him a god.
When it first came out.
Oh, you mean.
I was on NCAA.
Damn, son.
No, your number was.
Mike Vick.
Who was gone?
No, Mike Vick in NFL Street.
Oh, my God.
Yeah.
I forgot about that game.
NFL Street. Shit, we need to get that hoe in here. Then we can have like a little tournament.
Hell yeah!
You gotta turn this into a little like video game.
Well, we had like the number one Madden player in the world come on.
Oh, that's cool.
And he played Derek Lewis, and they both played each other in a game of Madden. I think Texans versus the Browns. We had the number one player.
We had at least 40 more people watch and listen to that than I expected. So.
Yeah,
it's awesome. There you go, exposure, man, exposure.
And we do have a nice spot right here, though.
True.
Yeah, I got
plugs.
Green Flash Brewery.
GreenFlashBrew.com. Alpine Beer Company. My Twitter is GreenFlash. Josh, if you want to, or at Sample75, I got two.
Nice.
If you're a Patriots fan, we watch the games at Diablo Loco. That's my home of the Pats.
Okay.
There's a couple other bars around town, and if you know, We got a Twitter at Houston Pats Fans. So, you know, hey, if you're a Pats fan, if you're not, no worries. No hate. You know, if you want to come make, if we lose against the Steelers, you want to come make fun of us, then we're there.
You know where we're at.
No,
hey, yeah. Next season, if they play the Broncos, I'm a Broncos fan.
Oh, well, I'm sorry.
Definitely come back. We can make a bet or something.
Yeah, we can. We can. We play the Texans next year and New Orleans, so I'm going all those games. So.
That's what's up.
Broncos.
But yeah, drink green flash beer.
Woo!
Hell yeah.
And then check out Jonny Bahama.
Definitely. And oh, yeah. And then, the 27th of this month, we're going to be at Rice University performing.
There you go.
I'm going to be with the Tommy, Tim Woods, you know, and EGP.
Valhalla? At Valhalla? Or?
Yeah, Valhalla's legit.
Yeah.
What? Have you been there?
I've never been there, but, you know, shit's starting to happen fast for me right now. So, a lot of shows coming up.
Nah, that's what's up, bro.
Stay in the loop, then.
Hey, I'm going to hit you up. Yeah. They don't got Green Flash.
Where else? www.southsidecollection.com. We got a show. He has a merch on.
Hold on, man. I got way.
Oh, yeah. He needed to plug a shirt.
I'm not even shouting out the sponsors, man.
Man.
Hold on, man.
Show your sponsors some love.
Hold
on, bro. There we go.
Hey.
We got Jake. Jake, throw me your hat so I can show it to the camera.
I got goodies.
Hey. Nice catch. Oh, yeah. Green Flash makes merch, too, guys.
We got merch. Yeah.
We got shirts, everything.
There you go. One time for Rage.
It's just something he came and dropped me up. We got so much more stuff, man. But shout out Rage, man. You know, they've been rocking with me. Shout out to Homie Rogue, and you know, shout out Central Underground and Southside Collection and all the people that have been fucking with me, definitely.
SouthsideCollection.com for all the goodies, Southside, C-O-L-L on Twitter, Southside Collection on Instagram.
Fuck with
and
us.
Southside Collection on Facebook. I mean, it's not that hard to find us.
And we're in person.
Do you have Snapchat yet?
I think we do. No, I think we do, but I think we basically treat the... There we go.
This man's got all the sponsors.
They're not my sponsors, but they're the fans.
Oh, okay, cool. I was about to say, man, we can't even get advertising on here until we get 10,000 viewers, so tell your friends.
Tell your friends. You keep rocking with Johnny, we're going to be there soon.
There we go.
Yeah.
All right, Southside Collection, we're fucking out.
Out.
Thank y'all very much for coming. Let's turn this off.
All right, let's figure out how to turn off this camera. Until then, just everyone.